anthropomorphic for everybody. That's pretty cool. Hey, welcome to the channel. Today we're going to be looking at the C-Ray, 50mm, 1.33 times anamorphic for Micro Four Thirds Fuji X-Mount and Sony E-Mount. Prior to Siri introducing this anamorphic lens, there were some low budget anamorphic options for people. SLR Magic has made some full lenses and also some adapters that you can use to adapt your regular spherical lenses. But I would say that the image quality of those lenses and adapters isn't really that great. They're not very sharp. And the adapters in particular, they're kind of clumsy, clunky, hard to work with. Typically you have to focus both like the adapter and the lens separately. There are other anamorphic adapters that you can track down a lot on eBay, but once again, they're kind of these clunky things that aren't really well suited for, like run and gun kind of low budget filmmaking. This little lens does away with all the hassle of using the adapters. Plus the quality is great. You get like a modern lens, modern build quality, modern image quality, and you get a 1.33 times anamorphic. So anamorphic lenses basically just take a 4:3 aspect ratio and stretch it out to 2.39:1 aspect ratio, which is what we're used to seeing in cinema. It's not always used, but it has been used for a long time. I would say since at least the 1950s, when it became really prevalent as a way to compete against television and as a way to preserve the full resolution of a super 35 millimeter film. Otherwise, if you want to get the same aspect ratio, you're going to have to crop off the top and bottom of the image and lose a lot of resolution in the process. Nowadays, with high resolution digital cameras, particularly those from RED, you can get a widescreen aspect ratio by cropping the tops and bottoms of the frame and still maintain plenty of resolution. But filmmakers still like to use anamorphic lenses for the imaging characteristics that are distinct from traditional spherical lenses. The most telling characteristic of an anamorphic lens is the lens flares that kind of streak out horizontally across the frame. Another giveaway is the vertically stretched out out of focus areas. So probably the most common anamorphic lenses are 2x anamorphic. They stretch out the image further than the 1.33 times anamorphic on the Siri lens. On the plus side, what the Siri lens does is takes a 16:9 image sensor and stretching it by 1.33 times gives you a 2:39:1 aspect ratio. So you don't really have to do a lot of work on your end. And furthermore, you don't have to crop off the sides in any way. So it's just a very easy workflow for run and gun, low budget filmmakers. If you're using a GH5 or GH5S like I am, those cameras have an anamorphic mode built into them. And what that does is instead of using 16:9 aspect ratio on the sensor, it uses a 4:3 aspect ratio. With a Siri lens, you don't need to use the 4:3 aspect ratio. You can use the 16:9 and you'll get the 2:39:1 aspect ratio. But if you do use the 4:3 aspect ratio, once you de-squeeze it, you'll get a 16:9 aspect ratio. Which means that if you want to use the anamorphic lens for like the cool lens flares and the sort of stretched out of focus areas, you can and still maintain your more normal 16:9 aspect ratio, which means you're not going to have letterboxes on your video. One issue that you might have to work around is if you are using cameras other than the GH5, GH5S, and the Pocket 4K, you're going to be looking at a squished image on your camera because most other cameras don't have a de-squeeze function to monitor your image. With the 1.33 times anamorphic, it's not so squished. So you can still monitor it okay. You can still see what's going on reasonably well. But if you do want to see what it's actually going to look like once you de-squeeze it, you can use an external monitor. And I would imagine that any external monitor that's made for filmmaking that's been released probably in the last 5 years has a de-squeezing function. So you can monitor in the 2:39:1 aspect ratio. So being a 50 millimeter lens for APS-C, whether that's Sony E-mount or Fuji X-mount cameras, you're getting around a 75 millimeter focal length equivalent. However, keep in mind that you're multiplying that by 33% and adding that to the sides of the image. So you're getting the same look as a 75 millimeter in terms of compression, but you're getting more field of view on the sides. For Micro Four Thirds, a 50 millimeter is going to be a 100 millimeter, so it's definitely a long lens. But again, you're getting a lot more information on the sides as you would a typical 100 millimeter lens. We'll talk a little bit about the build quality and kind of the technical specs of the lens. Build quality feels pretty great. It's completely metal. It's an all manual lens, so no electronics, no autofocus, nothing like that. It's pretty heavy. It weighs about, I think it's like 1.23 pounds, and that is 560 grams. So it's a pretty heavy lens. It's not overly big. It's a little bit longer than your typical mirrorless lens, mirrorless prime lens especially. I really like the focus ring. It's nice and smooth and has just kind of the right amount of resistance to allow you to get nice and accurate focus pulls. It has a pretty reasonably long focus throw of 143 degrees. Likewise, the aperture ring is nice and smooth. It's de-clicked, of course, because this is a cinema lens. But what issue I do have with the aperture ring is that it's a little bit too close to the base of the lens and thus puts it right up against the body of the camera. So especially if you use a cage on your camera, it's kind of hard to reach the aperture ring. So this is a cinema lens, and it would have been nice if they had geared the focus ring and the aperture ring so you could just mount a follow focus directly to it. As it is, you're going to have to come up with some sort of aftermarket gearing solution, which isn't a big deal, but it is something you'll deal with. And I don't think you could really gear the aperture ring considering how close it is to the camera body itself. Another negative with the lens in terms of build quality, while overall, it does seem like a really well-constructed, solid lens. It has a little bit of wiggle, a little bit of play when you mount it to the camera. And I don't know if that's going to be common across all of the different mounts for the camera, or if it's just Micro Four Thirds, or if it's just my lens. I wish it mounted just a little bit tighter to the camera. I mean, I'm not worried about it falling off, but it does kind of just shift around just ever so slightly. So you can screw filters directly onto the front of the lens, which is great. It takes a 67 millimeter filter. There are 10 aperture blades, so out of focus areas remain nice and round and soft. Another slight negative with the lens is the minimum focusing distance. It's not really a close focuser. The minimum focusing distance is 85 centimeters, which is 33.5 inches, which is just under 3 feet. So I'm not gonna do crazy in-depth analysis in terms of image quality. I would say it's pretty on par with a lens of this price range, you know, any modern lens that's come out in the last 20 years. At f1.8, it's a little bit soft, but I would say for video work, for 4K video, it's sharp enough for me. I don't think you need like tack sharp lenses for video necessarily, but it does sharpen up by 2.8, and I think probably 5.6 to 8 is probably the sweet spot in terms of sharpness. But once again, I wouldn't have any issue using this lens wide open. There are some chromatic aberration, which will show up in high contrast areas around some edges. You'll see some purple and green fringing, but as you stop down, it starts going away. And again, I don't really think it's a huge deal. You'll notice this on a lot of cinema lenses, a lot of, you know, photography lenses, but if you see it in movies, I wouldn't really complain too much about it for a lens like this. And focus breathing is pretty minimal. You can see it. I would say if the things in frame are relatively close that you're racking focus between, you won't really notice any focus breathing whatsoever. If your subjects are farther away, that's when you'll probably notice a little bit of focus breathing, but it's pretty minimal. So in conclusion, there is a lot to love about what Sirui is doing with this lens. For the price, you should be able to get it from just about all the major retailers right now for $699. When you consider the alternatives, I would say it's pretty amazing. There are some high quality anamorphic lenses for Micro Four Thirds that have started coming out that are, I think they're 1.8 times anamorphic from a company called Vaizen. But I think those are retailing for closer to $3,000 or $4,000. So they're more than three times as much as the Sirui anamorphic. One slight negative is that there's only this one lens available. And being a 50 millimeter for APS-C and Micro Four Thirds, it's definitely on the telephoto end of things. So it would be difficult to shoot an entire project with just this lens. However, sometimes constraints can lead to creative solutions, so it definitely would be worth trying if you had some ideas about shooting an anamorphic project. On the positive note, I know that Sirui is getting ready to launch another GoFundMe campaign for a 35 millimeter. So I think that's about it for this overview. I hope you found it useful. And if you have any questions, as always, leave them in the comments. Feel free to like this video if you liked it, dislike it if you're that kind of person. And feel free to subscribe if you want any more of these in-depth, important videos about camera stuff, which is very important, and you probably should subscribe. Anyway, thanks for watching this video.